Hello, this is my lecture number 7. First, I want to reiterate something that I presented in lecture 6. Let's say you're looking at the eigenvalues of the fundamental matrix of a dynamic system. These eigenvalues could be real or complex. Let's take a look at one particular eigenvalue. Let's say that it has a real part alpha and imaginary part omega. Obviously, somewhere you will find a conjugate to this eigenvalue. But presence of these eigenvalues, two complex conjugate eigenvalues, implies that in the natural motion of the system, you will observe this transient term. It will be a constant C times exponential of alpha times T times sinusoid or sine of omega T plus some phase. Phase depends on several conditions. Let's say that the eigenvalue is purely imaginary. Alpha is zero and omega is the imaginary part. Obviously, should be a conjugate with minus omega somewhere among eigenvalues. In this case, the appropriate transient term will be constant times sine of omega t plus phase. Phase depends on some additional factors. Let's say that eigenvalue of the fundamental matrix is purely real. In this case, the transient term, the transient component of the natural motion, will have constant C times exponential of alpha T. And finally, you may have eigenvalue equal to zero, and you don't expect to have only one. You may have several of them. Then transient terms will be constant. Of course, if you have two identical eigenvalues, you know the partial fraction expansion, you will have a ramp function. So this is the stuff that you should keep in mind. And at this point, I will start analysis of system statics and dynamics. I have to disappoint you. Analysis of control systems in the state variable space is not as elaborate as it is in the classical control. However, it still answers all questions. First of all, we start analysis, as you saw, from controllability, observability. The next issue is system stability, and system stability is extremely straightforward. And in the frequency domain, we do not consider stability when it comes to modern control. It's only we're looking at the real parts of the eigenvalues of the fundamental matrix. Now, analysis also includes statics and dynamics. Analysis of statics deals with steady state errors. Steady state errors, you look for in connection with system disturbance and system reference. Error associated with the reference also is known as the tracking error. So let me write down system equations. This is the state equation. In the state equation, you can see contribution of the control effort, and you see contribution of the disturbance. This is the output equation, and this is equation of the state variable controller. Now, the block diagram should remind you that we have a controlled plant defined by state variable notation. The state variable controller is shown right here. We have negative state variable feedback. Filter in the reference channel is always present. And there are two external forcing functions driving our system, the disturbance. Keep in mind the disturbance is applied directly, always applied directly to the input of the controlled plant. And the reference. A reference normally is applied through a special filter that we design to achieve certain effect on the system behavior. And then we're getting into the error business. Error caused by the disturbance is the system response to this disturbance. And in the lecture number 6, I showed you how to get system response, Y of S. So if in the expression for Y of S we will remove the control effort, the Y of S will be response only to the disturbance. And response to the disturbance we call error. For disturbance, it is matrix C times the fundamental matrix of the system with minus and SI with plus. This is in the power of minus 1. This is effectively SI minus the closed loop system's fundamental matrix. And then it is multiplied by matrix B of the disturbance and the disturbance itself. When it comes to the steady state error, I guess you have to take the limit of error as a function of S times S approaching the limit of this expression when S approaches zero. So look, error is limit of error as a function of time when time approaches infinity. This is equal, according to the final value theorem, limit S times the error of S when S approaches zero. And then take a look at this expression. Can you take the limit when S is zero? I guess you can. If S is zero, this term disappears, but this S will stay in front of the expression. And this S will counteract with the expression for the disturbance. So listen, this is the situation when disturbance is a unit step signal. We're looking at the error caused by disturbance. This is the steady state value definition in the time domain. This is the steady state value definition in the S domain. This is the same expression but explicitly written. Now keep in mind, if S approaches zero, this S will disappear. And in the case of step time disturbance, U disturbance of S is 1 over S, and 1 over S will be canceling this S in the front of the expression. And what you have here is the steady state error in the system with the state variable controller when input disturbance is a unit step. So this is what you have to keep in mind. Now, later you will be concerned about manipulating this error. You can manipulate this error, first of all, by changing matrix F of the controller. But if you're interested in more drastic measures to affect the error, keep in mind that matrix A is the fundamental matrix of the controlled plant. We cannot rebuild the controlled plant, but we can include integrator in the controlled plant. And then the order of the system will be increased by 1, and we can assume that control plant with the integrator is our new plant. And then matrix A will have additional column, an additional row. So we technically can manipulate a matrix A in this expression by introducing integrator in the system. However, there is a different way of looking at the integrator effect when we work within state variable domain. So this is what it is. This is the steady state error for unit step disturbance. How about the error for reference, the tracking error? Tracking error is defined as the discrepancy between the reference signal and the system's response to this reference. It's always the case. Now, if you're interested in the steady state tracking error, then of course you have to consider the limit of this discrepancy as time approaches infinity. So let's do some mathematics. This is the error as a function of time, the tracking error. It's obviously equal to reference minus system response to the reference. Now, in the situation like this, the disturbance effect should not be considered at all. We are assuming that there is no disturbance involved. We take a full advantage of the superposition principle. Now, the same expression is written here. This is the reference, and this is the system response to the reference. W is the filter, matrix filter in the reference channel. And then if we will make some simple mathematical transformations, we can also assume that we're dealing here with a system that has single input and single output. And in this case, reference R is a scalar. Scalar is factored out. And what you have is the error, tracking error, as a function of S. Let's consider taking the limit of this expression as time approaches infinity. In the S domain, S will be approaching infinity. We will multiply S by the error of S. And this is the expression that we have. Now, what if we're dealing with the unit step reference? If we deal with the unit step reference, what will happen? R of S will be 1 over S. And this limit will turn into the following. This SI term will disappear, and this S will cancel 1 over S. And this is what you will have for the tracking error. And I want to tell you that, first of all, the tracking error could be manipulated by choosing different values for matrix F. And also, should you introduce integrator in the system, matrix A, normally it describes, is the fundamental matrix of the control plant. But if you would consider controlled plant with the integrator, obviously this matrix A will have additional column and additional row. So this will be additional way of affecting the steady state error. Now, and I can manipulate with a extra column in the matrix A, an extra row in the matrix A associated with the integrator that was introduced, but it is a little bit confusing when you work in the S domain. Excuse me, when you work in the state space. Okay, and because of this, I just want you to take advantage of the table that we established in the classical control. This table is still usable in the advanced control, in the state variable control. When it comes to determining the steady state error caused by disturbance, let's take a look at the number of integrators in the system feedback. If there is none and disturbances step, error is a constant, not equal to zero. If there is no integrators in the system feedback, and disturbance is a ramp, then the steady state error is infinity. If we have one integrator in the system feedback and disturbance is step, steady state error is zero. And if there is one integrator in the system feedback, disturbance is a ramp, the steady state error caused by disturbance is a constant not equal to zero. At this point, I want you to keep this table in mind. Later, when we will get into the controller design, you will get these issues fully utilized, and you will re-examine these issues. When it comes to the steady state tracking error, we're not looking at the number of integrators in the feedback, we're looking at the number of integrators in the loop. And in the loop, they could be part of the forward path, or they could be part of the feedback. Now, error depends on the reference and the number of integrators. If reference signal is a step, and there is no integrators in the feedback, expect error to be constant. Now, in the state variable control, with the use of the filter, we may turn this constant to become zero. But at this point, let's assume that this is the case. If number of integrators in the loop is zero, no integrators, and if reference signal is a ramp, then the steady state tracking error is infinity. Is infinity. And later we will talk how to manipulate this error in the state variable control. If number of integrators in the loop is 1, references step, you will have a steady state tracking error equal to 0. And if number of integrators is 1 in the loop, the reference is a ramp. The steady state error is a constant, not equal to zero. So this is as much as I can tell you about the system statics. When it comes to system dynamics, our goal is to evaluate the settling time and the overshoot and the bandwidth. And in many cases, we need only overshoot and settling time. And there are cases when we are concerned only about the bandwidth of the system. Analysis of system dynamics. Analysis of system dynamics, if you're interested in the settling time, is aimed at the detection of the slowest transient component. Slowest transient component. And you understand that we have one transient component for every eigenvalue of the fundamental matrix. Now, the eigenvalues supposed to have negative real parts, otherwise a system will be unstable. At this point, the slowest eigenvalue will be the slowest term of the transient process will be the one that corresponds to the eigenvalue with the smallest real part. Smallest real part. This eigenvalue will decay, will be slowest in its decay. So I guess the answer is very simple. You go through the eigenvalue detection computation process. You look at the eigenvalues, at their real parts, and you select the one that has the smallest absolute value. 4 divided by this absolute value will give you settling time. It's exactly like we've been working with system pools in the classical control. Now, why divided by 4? Because it's a common agreement that settling time is time during which the transient component decays to 2% of its value at time 0. So this is convention. There is nothing new here comparing to the classical control. Yep, that's exactly what I said. You look for the eigenvalues of the fundamental matrix, but keep in mind, we're looking at the fundamental matrix of the closed loop system that is different and could be quite different from the fundamental matrix of the control plant. Nevertheless, you can compute it, detect eigenvalues, and find the one that has the smallest absolute value of the real part. 4 divided by the smallest absolute value of the real part will give you the settling time. Take a look at this expression. It defines the fundamental matrix of this system. In this expression, there is man-made matrix F that represents parameters of the controller, state variable controller. This matrix F could be strategically chosen to manipulate the system settling time. When we will get into the system design, you will have more evidence of how this is done. As far as the system overshoot for step response is concerned, it is completely the same determination as was presented to you in the classical controls in 361. First of all, if in 361 we were looking for the dominant poles in the state variable control, we have to look for the presence or determine if there are dominant eigenvalues of the fundamental matrix, which basically the same as dominant poles. The dominant one is the one that has a real part, absolute value of real part should be at least 4 times smaller than absolute values of real parts of all other eigenvalues. Nothing new about this. Now, this dominant eigenvalues could be present or system may not have them. So when it comes to evaluation of the overshoot for step response, you look at the presence of system zeros first. If there are system zeros present, and if there are dominant poles, and if there is no dominant poles in the system, zeros are present, dominant poles do not exist in the system. In this case, overshoot, you cannot evaluate except by simulation of the system step response. You want to know the overshoot? There are zeros in the control plant. There is no dominant poles. Run simulation of the step response. You will determine the overshoot. If zeros of the control plants are present, and also there are dominant poles, in this case, you also cannot determine the overshoot. You can't determine the settling time in any case. But whether there are dominant poles or not, there is no dominant poles. But the overshoot cannot be determined if there are zeros in the control plant. And then, if there are no zeros in the control plant, and you have one real dominant pole in the system, then the system response would be quite similar to the response, step response of a first order system, and overshoot is zero. And if there are no zeros in the control plane, transfer function, and if there are two complex conjugate dominant poles, then overshoot is consistent with the overshoot of a second order system with poles equal to those dominant poles. So this is not different from what you had in 361 class. System bandwidth. System bandwidth, again, as we discussed in 361, is the characteristic that shows the point in the frequency domain after which, beyond which, the system cannot loses the ability to follow sinusoidal components of the input signal. Okay, so if bandwidth of the system, let's say 10 radians per second, 9 radians per second sinusoid, the system can track all right. Sinusoid, 11 radians per second, the system effectively cannot track, because this frequency is beyond the bandwidth of the system. So how to address this reality? Modern control does not offer anything new. You have to get the closed loop system transfer function for the reference channel. Then you have to obtain the frequency response or frequency domain closed loop transfer function. And then by working with this transfer function, you can easily determine the system bandwidth. For example, closed loop frequency response of a reference to output channel, or closed loop frequency response. It is effectively 0 dB, but then it deviates from 0 dB, and it reaches -3 dB at some point. Beyond -3 dB, it is assumed that the system effectively cannot track sinusoidal signals with the frequency greater than this limit for the bandwidth. So I guess the bandwidth is formally defined as the closed loop system frequency response. Where magnitude or point of the closed loop system frequency response, where magnitude reaches -3 dB, the bandwidth of the system. However, we will invest more time in bandwidth, and then there is another characteristic, disturbance rejection characteristic. We will work with these characteristics when we will get into the system design. At this point, I expect you to start working on the homework number 5. And I really insist that you do this homework yourself. Perhaps it's a good idea to work in groups. However, even if you work in the group, you have to understand fully what other group members have done with respect to the homework problems. Because at some point, you will have the midterm exam. And midterm exam will be quite important for your final grade. Now we will talk about the design of single input, single output control systems. This is our next topic. Well, system design is the most important problem in control engineering. Application of state variables enables the designer to work with high-dimensional systems and do what classical control engineers were never able to achieve. At the same time, when you will look at the control law defined in the state space, you will realize that numerically it does not contain any derivatives, and numerically it basically is based on multiplication and addition, which are quite straightforward and easy to implement mathematical operations, or rather arithmetical operations. The approach that we will use is known as the pole placement procedure. Let me tell you this. This is the state equation of the controlled plant. This is the output equation of the controlled plant. Eventually it will be output equation of our system. And this is equation of the controller. In the equation of the controller, this is the filter in the reference channel. This is the reference signal. This is matrix F of the controller. X is the state vector. Take a look at minus of X, what it is. It's a linear operation, quite simplistic from the mathematical, or I wouldn't use mathematical, from the computational point of view. And it defines the state variable feedback, negative state variable feedback. The controller of this type is known as the negative state variable feedback controller. Now, when we design a system, we have to satisfy a set of design specifications. The specifications are not necessarily independent. They may duplicate each other. But first of all, we have to achieve the certain required settling time in seconds. We have to achieve the allowed, or not to exceed, the allowed overshoot of the step response. Now, the settling time is the same for the entire system. But the step response is always specified for the step reference input. There is no such thing as the overshoot for disturbance signal. And there is no such thing as the overshoot for the ramp input. Step response is always defined for a reference step. We have to achieve the allowed steady state error for a unit step disturbance. Sometimes it could be allowed steady state error for a ramp disturbance, which doesn't happen that often. Now, we have to satisfy requirements on the allowed steady state tracking error for a ramp disturbance, for a ramp reference, excuse me. Now, this allowed steady state tracking error could be defined for a step reference, but for a step reference, it's very easy to satisfy this requirement. For a ramp type reference is the challenge. There are problems and situations when we will be concerned with the system bandwidth, and there is disturbance rejection in decibels that has to be assured in some specific applications. What is the system design about? System design calls for the selection of matrix F and the filter matrix W, and sometimes this filter W is not a matrix, but rather a transfer function. However, this transfer function could be always represented in a matrix vector form. Generally speaking, at this point, let's assume that W is a matrix filter in the reference channel. Now, this matrix F and this matrix W should be chosen such that with the existing matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C, we would satisfy those specifications that will be imposed on our design process, not necessarily all of them. You know, typically, system design does not have a unique solution, and this is the moment where experience, intuition, qualification of the system designer will make a difference. Let me start from the simplest, from assuring the settling time and overshoot for the designed system. And we will use a numerical example that probably is the most straightforward way to present this material to students. Let's say we have a fifth order controlled plant. And this controlled plant is defined by this state variable form. And by looking at this state variable form, you should immediately realize we're dealing here with a canonical controllable form. And because of this, you should question the how realistic the individual state variables are, but this is beyond the point right now. You have the state variable, canonical controllable form for the control plant. The design specifications call for the settling time of 4 seconds and the overshoot of step response under 10%. You can make overshoot 1% and 2% and 3% below the maximum allowed overshoot, but it is not recommended because each time when you make overshoot lower, you're paying the price for this. And we'll talk about this later. So I would disadvise you to exceed specifications. If overshoot shall not exceed 10%, make it 10%. If you would take a look at these state equations, for a single input, single output system, you will realize that matrix F is a row matrix. And in our case, it is a row matrix that has 5 terms, F1, F2, F3, F4, and F5. Now, if you would take a look at our state equations, you will also conclude that filter W is just a scalar for a single input, single output system. Like we did in the undergraduate, in the classical control class, before we will get engaged in the design, let's make sure that the control plant does not have any right-hand side zeros. Okay? No right-hand side zeros in the control plant, because right-hand side zeros create a difficulty in system design. We will overcome this difficulty very soon. But at this point, make sure that there is no zeros. How to find this out? We don't have explicitly defined polynomial numerator. It's not a big deal. Look at the matrix C. From the matrix C, you should be able to reconstruct the polynomial numerator of the transfer function. You will get it by inspection because of this beautiful canonical controllable form. Well, if you would not have canonical controllable form, then you would have to go through the matrix definition of the transfer function of the control plant, and then you would represent it by a polynomial form. You will be able to determine the zeros and make sure because you have to make sure that there is no zeros in the right hand side. All right, so look, this is the matrix C, and this is the numerator of the control plane transfer function reconstructed by inspection from matrix C. If you would run the root finder procedure, you will find out that the zeros are minus 4 plus minus j, minus 2 plus minus 3j. Thank God, minus 4 is in the left-hand side. With minus 2, they are also in the left-hand side. There is no right-hand side zeros, and we can proceed with the design procedure. What will happen if we will introduce the state variable feedback controller? With the state variable feedback, the fundamental matrix of our closed loop system will be A minus BF. And then, when we will talk about overshoot and the settling time of the design system, we will be working with the eigenvalues of this closed loop system's fundamental matrix. So our goal is this. We have to make sure that the closed loop system has such eigenvalues that the overshoot and the settling time requirements will be satisfied. So we will provide closed loop system, fundamental matrix of the closed loop system, with the required, with the desired eigenvalues. Therefore, our approach is known as the eigenvalue assignment, or eigenvalue assignment problem. All right. First of all, let's choose two complex conjugate dominant poles that would be responsible for the required overshoot and the settling time. You know, if overshoot required would be zero, then I guess there would be no need in working with two complex conjugates. We would choose one dominant pole. But in our situation, the overshoot is required or expected to be 10%. Therefore, we have to have two complex conjugate dominant poles, or two complex conjugate eigenvalues for the fundamental matrix A closed loop. I will call this eigenvalues minus alpha plus minus j beta. Immediately you will realize that if these two eigenvalues are dominant, then the settling time is 4 divided by alpha. Well, alpha is equal 4 divided by the required settling time. In our case, since settling time should be 4 seconds, alpha is 1. Now, how to handle the problem with regards to the overshoot of the step response? Well, if second order system has damping ratio of 0.6, we know from our classical control, from known properties of the second order system, overshoot is 10%. So if we want overshoot to be 10%, these two complex conjugate poles should be such that the equivalent second order system, second order term, would have a damping ratio of 0.6. But alpha is already taken. Alpha has been chosen equal to 1 to assure the settling time. How do we handle the overshoot? By omega, of course, by omega. Now, if you will write down the solution for the two poles of a second order system defined by a canonical form of the second order system. You know, the real part will be equal to minus damping ratio times omega. The imaginary part will be equal to plus minus damping ratio plus minus omega times 1 times square root of 1 minus damping ratio squared. So, look, if you want to understand this or recall this material, take a look into the 361 textbook. But if we want to define the ratio between the omega and alpha, the imaginary part and the real part of two complex conjugate poles, this ratio should be this, where xi is the damping ratio. If I will, in other words, the imaginary part will be equal to alpha times the square root 1 minus damping ratio squared divided by the damping ratio. But for 10% overshoot, damping ratio is 0.6. So if I would insert 0.6 in this expression, I will find out that the omega, the imaginary part, will be equal to 1.33. And therefore, the two desired dominant poles for the, or dominant eigenvalues, if you prefer, for the fundamental matrix are minus 1 plus minus 1.33j. You know, these two poles have been, or two eigenvalues have been determined, but they must be dominant. They must be dominant. And we have a 5x5 fundamental matrix. So three more eigenvalues have to be chosen. How you choose them? To make sure that the dominance of these two complex conjugates, minus 1 plus minus 1.33, will not be affected. They must stay dominant. And therefore, I have many various choices. But for example, if I would choose minus 4 plus minus 4j and minus 6 for three other poles or three other eigenvalues, we still will have the dominant ones dominant. All right? So this is one of the choices. If you would choose minus 40 plus minus 75j and minus 50, it still will be acceptable. There are many choices you can make, infinite number of choices. However, don't be weird when you make these choices. If you would have minus 40 million plus minus 90,000 J, people will be making some wrong conclusions about your mental status. So one way or another, let's say that these are the non-dominant eigenvalues and these are the dominant eigenvalues, or these are non-dominant poles and these are the dominant poles of the system. How the characteristic polynomial of the system should look like? S minus first dominant pole, S minus second dominant pole, S minus first non-dominant, S minus second non-dominant, and S minus non-dominant number 3. And if you prefer, perform the multiplication, and there is software tools that you can use, I hate you wasting time doing this arithmetics. This is the polynomial. So you see, this is the characteristic polynomial of a system that would have exactly what we want to have, the settling time and the overshoot of 10%, providing that the overshoot will not be affected by zeros. You know the direct decomposition, and if this is the characteristic polynomial of the closed loop system, or desired characteristic polynomial of the closed loop system, then by inspection, you should be able to define the fundamental matrix of the system. It's no problem. No brainer. This is done by inspection. This is the closed loop, system's fundamental matrix, or fundamental matrix of the closed loop system. But at the same time, how do we define this fundamental matrix for the closed loop system? This is the fundamental matrix of the controlled plant, minus matrix B times matrix F. And if you perform these operations, this is what you will get. This is what you will get. And this is what you want to have. And therefore, how to turn this result into what we want it to be? By making sure that this term is equal to this term, and this term is equal to this term, and so on. So you will be able to determine elements of matrix F from this result. And we're done. We established the matrix F of the state variable controller. How the transfer function of the system would look like? Yep, it looks like this. Matrix C, and this is a transfer function for the reference input. Matrix C, SI, minus A, plus BF, and the power of minus 1 times B. Any computer tool will give you this result. And this is the result in our case. And you would immediately tell me that as far as the settling time is concerned, you are in great shape as far as the overshoot of the step response is concerned. Situation is unpredictable because the system has zeros, and actually the system inherited zeros of the controlled plant. But we are system designers. How to get rid of this numerator? Easy. If I would place this filter in the reference channel, in series with the closed loop system that we built, this will be the overall transfer function. This transfer function will cover the reference, filter in the reference channel, and the control plant with its closed loop system. Now, what will happen if we would apply a unit step reference to the input of the system? The result will be exactly equal to, you don't have to be a genius to figure it out. If I would drive this system with the unit step reference, the steady state value will be equal to 1 divided by 531.6. And this should be fixed. Because if you apply a reference equal to 1, a step with the magnitude of 1, this means only one thing. You want the system response steady state value to have magnitude of 1. How to handle it? You have to modify this filter in the reference channel. Insert this coefficient in the numerator of this filter. And now what will happen? You will have a perfectly defined system. Now, this is the state variable definition of the controlled plant. Here you have the system output. Here you pick up state vector and create state variable feedback. The filter, initially I called it W. And when I discussed this filter in general terms, I called it matrix. What kind of matrix? It's a 1x1 matrix. And this matrix, in order to eliminate zeros of the controlled plant and zeros of the closed loop system, of the equivalent closed loop system, it has to be a S-domain filter, dynamic filter. And this is H of S. It is defined right now. I am sure that if you would apply reference step, you will have the required settling time and the steady state value of the system response to the reference will be equal exactly to the magnitude of the step reference. So, from this point of view, the system is designed. Well, of course, you have to keep in mind that disturbance is applied directly at the input of the control plant, and disturbance may result in its, or will result in a special error, and this error could be subjected to further analysis. And maybe we will have, and maybe we will end up redesigning the system. You know, look at this result. Look at this result. These are the eigenvalues of the closed loop system's fundamental matrix chosen to have the required settling time and system overshoot. They are all different. There is no identical eigenvalues among those that we chose. Why not? Because it is not allowed to have identical eigenvalues in this situation. All eigenvalues must be different. Why? Because if you remember partial fraction expansion, there will be a dynamic component, a transient component associated with each eigenvalue. Now, if we have identical eigenvalues, then dynamic component will look like E in the power of whatever absolute value times T. Then it will be multiplied by time and then by sinusoid of the omega T plus phase. So this type of component is not a purely exponential component. It will be a kind of weird combination of a ramp function with an exponential. And having this type of terms in the system, natural motion is not advisable. And therefore, I want you to keep in mind that when you assign eigenvalues, make sure that they are all different. Look, you just realized that our design procedure was quite straightforward, was quite simplistic and easy to understand, because the controlled plant was represented by a CCF. If we would not have a CCF, if we would deal with an arbitrary form of the state variable description of the control plant, the design procedure would be much more difficult. But it's very unrealistic to expect that the control plant will be represented by CCF. And moreover, if control plant is represented by CCF, this means that the state variables are fictitious variables. They're not voltages, they're not currents, they're not accelerations. They are linear combinations of real physical signals. And therefore, there is no way one can establish a sensor to monitor these variables. Then look, if your control plant is defined by a CCF, state variables are fictitious, how would you design the state variable feedback, where you would get this particular state variables from? So, in the realistic situation, we have to assume that we're dealing with an arbitrary form of the state variable description. And we're dealing with real physical signals that we can monitor. So look at this expression. It is a state variable definition of a control plant. Now let's assume that x1 and x2 and x3 and so on, they are all real physical signals. And therefore, this expression, this definition, is based upon laws of physics. This is much more realistic situation. How to take advantage of the simplicity that we have in the case of CCF? Well, I guess it's time to transform to CCF this description. How to define, how to perform this transformation? I guess you remember, or you should remember. Now, the key to this transformation is some matrix filter. Let me call it M in this situation. How to define M? First, you have to build this matrix S, then you have to invert this matrix S, then you have to cut out the last row of this matrix S, and you will call it matrix D, and finally, you will build the conversion filter. Right now, I call it M, because name is irrelevant. I call it M. M is a N by N matrix, where N is the order of our system. Now, I am converting arbitrary form into CCF. So right now, Z is the state vector of the canonical controllable form. Matrix A1 is the fundamental matrix of the canonical controllable form, and so on. You remember that A1 is defined as matrix M times matrix A times M minus 1. Matrix B1 of the CCF is defined as matrix B, matrix M times matrix B. Matrix C1 of the CCF is defined as matrix C of the arbitrary form times matrix M in the power of minus 1. So we perform this transformation, and now we can proceed with our design problem without any delays. We have to do every single step that was shown to you earlier for CCF. This is the control law defined for CCF variables. We eventually will get this control law. As far as the filter in the reference channel, it's exactly the same filter, regardless whether we have CCF or have arbitrary form, it's not important. Now it's time to implement the system. Is there difficulty in the system implementation? Sure it is. Look, this is the control law. This control law utilizes filter, and you know how to build this filter. It utilizes the reference input. You know reference is the customer's cup of tea. This is the matrix F of the state variable controller, and this is vector Z that comprises fictitious variables. With fictitious variables, this control law cannot be implemented. Now it is time to recall how to obtain Z, this Z, from real physical variables. Z is equal to M times X, where M is the matrix that we use for conversion to CCF. And because of this, we have to replace in this expression Z by MX. And of course, we will define matrix F as F1 times M. And now we have the system designed. And such a system could be implemented. Therefore, I had an opportunity to demonstrate one of the key issues in modern control. In modern control, you should be able to switch from one state variable form to another in order to facilitate or simplify solution of the particular problems.